Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dear brothers and sisters, welcome back to Youth Challenges. Now, for those of you who have just joined us, today's discussion is on Salah, the importance of Salah, and a number of other factors surrounding Salah in Islam. So just before the break, me and Mulana Ahmad Karim Sahib were discussing in which situations it is permissible to miss your Salah. Now, Mulana Sahib very clearly summed up how severe this situation is, that in the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him, even during war, Salah was still an obligation. So that leads us to ask ourselves then, what excuse do we have not to pray our Salah? You know, Mulana Sahib, one thing I always found quite beautiful was, like, this is the beauty of Islam. Mm-hmm. If you can stand up, mm-hmm. if you can stand up and pray your Salah. Mm-hmm. If you can't stand, mm-hmm. if you're feeling too weak, if it's any kind of disability, if you're not feeling well, if you're sick but you can't stand and pray, you can sit down and pray, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy for you. Mm-hmm. And even if you can't sit down and pray, Mulana Sahib, you can actually lay down and mm-hmm. pray if you can't sit. And similarly, if there is water, you can do wudu with water, and if there is not, you can use the dirt. And if there is not access to the ground, the dirt, you can use the air. So it comes to show the beauty of Islam in the sense that it's the simplicity and the beautification of it. So it leads us to ask ourselves, you know, what excuse do we have? Mm. You know, was there no water to make wudu? Mm. You know, did we not have the health, physical health to stand up and pray Salah? Mm. So it really, we need to ask ourselves this question. And a lot of people would use the excuse, you know, I was at work. But as you mentioned, Mulana Sahib, a chain smoker will manage to smoke anywhere. So when you were at work, did you get a smoke break for 15 minutes? Did you get a toilet break? You know, did you get your lunch break? And it's just, have you spoken to your employer, whether you can or you can't pray, or you can take 10 minutes out? You know, these kind of things, they're very easy to use them as excuses. But when we reflect upon ourselves, you have to ask, you know, are you doing enough? Have you actually tried to make sure that there's no obstacles preventing you from praying? Mm. So, definitely this is a very disheartening and upsetting fact. Living in the
actually,
West.
Actually, you know what happened, Faizan, as I said, that where there is a will, there is a way. When you accept that, I will not leave my Salah at any circumstances, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make 100,000 ways.
Yeah.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide you. Because many of my friends, they have musalla in their cars.
Yeah.
And I never seen that they you know, and they every time they get the proper place for salah and they perform salah.
Yeah.
One of my friends, he did master's in computer sciences and later he started his... Initially, he didn't find good job. So he had to do the call center. So outbound calling and based on, you know, the sales-oriented jobs. So every day he was worried. He said that somebody fired somebody because he didn't meet the target. So maybe next time, because my English is not very good. But one thing he was doing, he was a regular in Salah. So because he had to dial constantly dialing, so he asked them to give me break. They said, we have no break. He said, I have to have a break because this is my Salah. So you can take money from that. I can do this, all right.
Yeah.
Believe me, Faizan, within 6 months, he has a very good position in a computer science department and later become head of the computer science department. How is that? Because he has a firm belief where I have to do munajat, where I ask to, we ask the doors of people, help me, help me. Your Lord ask. Okay, come to me 5 times, help me.
Yeah.
So I'm providing you. The Salah is not only the connection, Salah is you're asking the dua, supplication. Salah is the closeness of to your Lord.
Yeah.
It is not a burden. It is good for us. You know, if anybody, King asks me, to, there is a meeting point to come here, so I say, no, I have no time.
Mm.
So how is that? Is it possible?
Yeah, definitely, Mulana Sahib. And Mulana Sahib, that is actually the beauty. It's so beautiful to think, you know, Mulana Sahib, if, for example, I asked you to see me 5 times a day, it's very difficult, you know. And if, you know, you call upon someone 5 times a day, no one will be able to give you that kind of presence, that kind of attention. But how beautiful is our religion that 5 times a day, your Lord is calling you, you know, come to me.
And
5 times a day.
And the beauty is in our Sharia, Shariat-e-Muhammadi, is that all the earth Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make a sajood of the person. We can do sajda anywhere.
Yeah.
It is not compulsory to go to masjid. You are at your job place, you are in school, you are anywhere. So you take your time, 5 minutes, you do your salah.
Yeah.
And you know, in youth time, you can retain your wudu for longer period. In my age, it is difficult to retain wudu for. But I asked my son and my daughter, they can retain their wudu, you know, the 8 hours, 10 hours, very easily.
Yeah.
Wudu in the morning, and they perform all salah.
Especially during this time of year, it's like a secret blessing.
Yeah.
Wudu salah is so close to each other. Cool.
You can easily do.
So definitely, Mawlana Sahab. And Mawlana Sahab, what I want to ask you then is, you know, with regards to people who are working, for example, or maybe they are struggling to find time a little bit, this is another thing which a lot of youth especially, they don't realize, is with regards to the manner in which you can pray your salah. Now, Mawlana Sahab, if you can just clarify for us, is it permissible to just pray your fard, your fard salah, and not pray the sunnah or the nafil?
Mm. Actually, salah comprises fard, wajib, sunnat-e-muqadda, sunnat-e-ghair-muqadda, nafil. Those are all the elements in salah. Further, you cannot leave at any cost. Further reduced when you are traveling, when you are in the mode of traveling. And then wajib. What are the wajib in the three witr in Isha time? So if you miss your fard, you have to do qada of your fard. Qada is like you do tawbah. For example, fard namaz, I miss my zuhur prayer. And then what happened? I will do my fard prayer again, only fard, because fard is compulsory. And wajib. Wajib is the Isha three witr, so you have to repeat your three witr. And otherwise, in Sunan, Sunnat Muqadda and Ghair Muqadda, it is not compulsory to perform. But scholar says that Sunnat Muqadda are those, you know, the prayer, Prophet ﷺ constantly performed that one. So if you constantly leave that, then you become sinful.
Mm.
You know, once you are in a job, so you cannot perform, you have only 5 minutes, do fard.
Mm.
So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it.
Definitely. Thank you, Mawlana Sahab. And I think that's very relevant considering that a lot of people at work, they will refrain from praying their salah because they think that they can't, you know, find the time for it. Whereas, you know, in that situation, it will be okay to just pray your fard. So Mawlana Sahab, what I want to ask you now is, this is something which I would say concerns everyone, even the people that pray their 5 salah a day, even the ones that don't, even some people who are trying and maybe they fear only 1 or 2 salahs a day. But the reason this is relevant is because even when you are praying, your salah is something which, you know, requires a lot of attention, a lot of kind of spiritual practice, because it's difficult to perfect your salah. You know, a lot of people, they can be praying, you know, and even whilst they are physically, they are doing the motion, and physically they are reading the ayah and the, you know, du'as, what might happen is their mind is actually somewhere else. They can be thinking about something completely unrelated to their salah. They can doze off, they can maybe read 1 rakat extra, 1 rakat, let's forget which rakat they're on, you know, and not pray with the precise intention that they should be doing. So Mawlana Sahab, firstly, what I want to ask is, what are some of the causes of this? And secondly, how can one perfect his salah?
It is a very important question. People mostly ask this question. First thing is that the etiquette of salah is that when you are doing salah, you forget everything.
Yeah.
Allah says in Quran, "Wazkur rabbaka wa tabattal ilayhi tabtila." When you engage yourself in the remembrance of Allah, you cut yourself from all dunya. So physically, what we're going to do that, we go masjid five minutes before. Because I go just 1 minute, I'm still in that frame of mind.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if I go 5 minutes before, I sit there, I engage in a little bit of zikr. So now my mind is there. What happened? I park my car on double yellow line, or I park my car 15 minutes, and now I'm thinking, it's obvious, I'm a human.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, maybe I got ticket. So there are some physical factors I have to address.
Yeah.
And it is addressed in a hadith as well. There's a hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, narrated. She said, the Prophet said that if you are hungry, so eat first, then you perform salah.
Uh-huh.
Meaning all those physical factors then can divert your attention anywhere else. So address them. But keep in your mind, doesn't mean, you know, for the Maghrib salah and not you are leaving. You have a time for salah. You have a time, half an hour, half an hour. So food served, so you eat food. And the similar is that you need to go to toilet. It is makruh, dislike act. Now you are feeling some pressure and you go to salah. No, first you go. So now you are, what happened? Mentally you are now, you're in peace of mind. You're in peace of mind. So first of all, physical factors. You address physical factors. You park your car properly. You come masjid before time. You are not so much hungry. Now you are in that calm position. You can concentrate. Now the second factor comes. Allah says that ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la taqrabus salata wa antum sukara. Don't approach your salah in the feeling of intoxication. Meaning, if you are intoxicated, what you are saying you don't know. Sukara means what you are saying you don't know. Some scholars, they also give another interpretation of this verse. They say, what you are saying, you don't know. I know what I am saying. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Yeah. I don't know. So, meaning of salah. If you learn the meaning, we read few surahs. Surah Fatiha is compulsory. Everybody knows that. Even a person knows the meaning of this surah. And then you focus on that, what I am saying it. So, what you are doing it, so you feel it. Physical actions backed by your spiritual feelings. Physical actions are you takbir, Allah is great. And physical actions is backed by you are standing and so you say that Allah is grandeurful. You bow. Now you have this feeling. If you know the meaning, what you are saying it. Now you are praising to Allah and after that you are making dua. So your mind is there. So scholar says that a person must know the meaning. What they are doing, what a regular, you know, the surahs, he must know the meaning. And also, physically, he is not doing any movement in salah, like itching, like this, like mobile is your on. And sometimes, you know what happens? Some people, they look at that and then put it in the pocket. So it is in salah. So don't look here and there. In salah, you can't give the answer to any person, otherwise your salah is broken.
Definitely, Moran Sahab, that was amazing. And I think that is some advice which the youth of today and everyone should actually take on board is that, you know, understand what you are reading.
But you are doing it, so you should understand. And there is a verse in Quran, Allah says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Successful are those faithful believers, those have a khushu in their prayer. Khushu means totally absorbed in their prayer. So try to absorb in your prayer. Even you don't know the meaning, you feel it. I'm standing in front of my Lord. And you start, you know, that feeling gives you tears in your eyes. That is the salah.
Definitely, Mulan Sahab. Thank you for that. You know, Mulan Sahab, now what I want to ask you is with regards to the age at which salah becomes compulsory. Because once again, this is one of the aspects which is misconceived. A lot of people, they don't realize at what age they should start telling their son or daughter to start praying, at what age they should start kind of training them to pray. And what happens is that has an effect later on in life, especially during the teenage years, is where young teenagers, they're not on their salah, because to be honest, quite frankly, they were never actually introduced to the concept of salah, and neither were they motivated or encouraged to start praying salah. So at what age is it actually compulsory?
Yeah, before going to your question, I'm telling another thing I would like to address with my viewers. It is very, very important. Allah says in Quran, "Udu ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'izati al hasanati." You call people towards deen with wisdom. That is a very missing link. When I ask my child, I ask in a polite manner and tell the, you know, the importance of salah. And the benefits we get for salah. So that make the child's heart towards salah. And also, you know, when my child is very little, I bring my child to masjid. That make a routine. Well, one of my child is very, very young. He's about not even the 3 years. But, you know, when he hears azan, he say, namaz, namaz, namaz. Before me, he is ready. Because he goes with me. He's so much excited to go, and that becomes, that is why in Islam, there is a hadith, when your son reaches at the age of 7 years, so then you start teaching salah and train train him salah. When he becomes the age of 10, you become harsh if he is not performing salah. Yeah. But at that age of puberty, there is no excuse. Because you know that in puberty age, in Islam, there is a difference of opinion. Puberty age, when a person reaches at that point, some children, they get the puberty before their age. If you have a sign of puberty even before your age, so you are considered that you are adult now in Islam.
Yeah. Definitely, Mawlana Sahib. Thank you for summing that up quite well. Now, Mawlana Sahib, the next thing I want to go on to, we have spoken a lot about masjid and praying in the mosque, but just to pay a little bit of particular focus on that, first question I want to ask you is, what are the benefits of praying in congregation, you know, together?
There are many, many benefits. The first benefit is the 25 to 27 more reward. There is the authentic hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, Prophet says that if a person performs salah in jamaat, so he will get reward 27 times more.
Wow.
So now what happened in you know, the Black Friday or the other days, we become panic. Why? We are getting discount, 50% discount. So if a person says that 200%, 300%, so why? We become stand in the queues. So we should also think about 27 times the similar effort you put it. So first thing is great reward. Why Allah put the great reward for that? You become trained for many things. Number one, you've been being trained. You know, you say that the group dynamic, team, you know, coordination, you work as a team, you go there and you follow discipline. Now the salah time is 7 o'clock. Mm-hmm. In my home, I can read 7:30, 7:25. But there is 7 o'clock, you become a discipline for that 7 o'clock. Now you follow the Amir, Imam is there. Even you bow before Imam, your salah become invalid.
Oh, wow.
It is so important. Some people, they are very, you know, they are doing it very quickly. Imam just say Allahu Akbar before going ruku, he goes. So your salah become invalid. Because what happened? Ata'at-e Amir, leadership. So follow the leader, this quality you will. Then you stand shoulder to each other. A rich person, maybe he is a president, and maybe you are working as a blue collar job, but you stand before equality. Then what happened in the time of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, if a person is missing in a salah, they will go to that the person's house. They went to his house and asked that, what happened? He is sick or ill? You know the circumstances of the people. And also in Islam, it is recommended, I do go to the masjid nearer to my house, not to leave that masjid, go to other masjid. Because in my area, this is a circle, so people know to each other, now we know each other's circumstances. If a person in need, if a person is sick, if a person is that is our civic hub.
Yeah.
How many, you know, the blessings of, you know, the person is sick, nobody knows that.
Yeah.
But if you are regular musalli, everybody knows that, everybody is doing dua for you, everybody is coming to your house and asking you.
Definitely, Mawlana Sahib, thank you so much for that. And Mawlana Sahib, thank you, because I've had a very interesting discussion with yourself, and I'm sure the viewers have enjoyed the conversation today and learned a thing or two, actually. And until next time, Mawlana Sahib, unfortunately, we have come towards the end of our hour. So dear viewers, until next time, take care of yourselves, of your family, and of your loved ones. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.